Sleep and Sleep Disorders, Part 4. Epidemiology of Sleep Disorders. Until now, we've been talking about the physiology of sleep, about the mechanisms that regulate sleep, and I presented three classifications of sleep disorders used around the world. However, now I'd like to present a question that is more clinical, concerning much more the illnesses and the patients with them. I'll also present the epidemiology and consequences of insomnia, as well as treatment methods for selected disorders. Spreading the word is the main aspect of the situation in Poland. My practice at the present time is operating an outpatient clinic for treating sleep disorders. I'm proud to say that it is the first such clinic in Poland and the largest. We're also pioneers breaking through various official barriers as well as getting through to patients. At present, the clinic occupies a strong position on the medical landscape and having its own independent status as a specialist clinic and its own
status poradni specjalistycznej, własny samodzielny kontrakt.
To begin, I'd like to say a few words about our clinic.
Na temat tej naszej poradni
zgłaszalności. The application rate.
Może jeszcze znowu króciutko, jeśli chodzi o aspekt historyczny.
Perhaps a little history is in order.
Którym pracuję, czyli klinika
psychiatric clinic at the Medical University of Warsaw was without a doubt a pioneer in the field of sleep medicine or the study of sleep in Poland. First work was done there in the 1960s. When I came to work there in the mid-80s, it was already a sleep research laboratory.
Wcześniej.
The founding of a clinical center next to the lab was also a natural development.
Klinicznego, zajmującego się pacjentami, był jakby naturalnym rozwojem. I tak się zresztą działo.
Ja zajmowałem się badaniami sleep disorders in depression, in anxiety disorders, in patients addicted to alcohol. In the course of these research studies, patients with various elements began coming in seeking help. I took the liberty of compiling statistics. At first they were single individuals, 1, 2, 3, 8, 11 people coming in over the course of a year. In the mid-1980s, there were quite a few of these patients, and they required a lot of attention. The idea of setting up a clinic was born. It was a unique idea in Poland. Of course, similar clinics were being established all over the world. All of them had similar beginnings. They arose around those centers and began treating sleep disorders, not just studying sleep itself. And so we began to open up to the world and to patients. As you can see, it was very necessary because you can see that the tempo of patients applying at the clinic has risen geometrically over the past few years. This is a clear signal that there exists a need for this type of medical treatment and for this type of healthcare facility. I might just add that when we look at the problem of sleep disorders from the aspect of society, we can clearly see that as a problem it is unappreciated and underfinanced in an administrative sense. Currently we accept around 500 new patients each year and we treat several thousand yearly. Last year we had a situation where patients signed up to a waiting list and in the course of 2-3 months we exhausted the entire yearly patient limit designated us.
W ciągu pierwszych 2-3 miesięcy wyczerpali cały limit.
This situation this year is similar.
Przez kasy chorych.
It may get even worse. As this year our limits have been reduced.
W roku kasy chorych na odchodnym.
Fortunately, we don't keep to those limits very stringently, and even now we're accepting over double the number of patients we've contracted for.
Dwukrotnie większą liczbę niż to wynikało z wcześniej zakontraktowanych usług. Ale pacjenci, którzy zapisują się na
rzadko muszą czekać several months to be seen.
Tak to po prostu unfortunately,
that's a result of the way our national health service is structured and organized. The system of treating patients is dependent on the type of illness. The system in the case of insomnia is different from the system for narcolepsy. But generally, a patient who comes to us is assured of at least several more visits during the course of a year in order so he may be diagnosed properly and taught to sleep.
Zaraz do poradni ma zapewnionych co najmniej kilka lub kilkanaście wizyt w ciągu roku po to, żeby problem odpowiednio rozpoznać, odpowiednio tego pacjenta zaopatrzyć, nauczyć go spania.
The number of visits is 2,000 to 3,000 annually, and it's a drop in the bucket. There could easily be 10 such clinics in Poland, and none of them would want for patients.
Jeśli chodzi o charakterystykę pacjentów,
let me show you a distribution based on age. As I mentioned in part one of this program, insomnia is a disorder that increases with age. And so we can clearly see that the older the patients are, the more often they come in. Up to a point, of course.
Starsi, tutaj mamy przedział wiekowy, tym tych pacjentów zgłasza się coraz więcej, no do pewnego etapu.
These oldest may not have enough strength to break through all the organizational structures.
Organizacyjne struktury, natomiast chciałem przekazać
something else that's characteristic for Polish patients.
Dosyć charakterystyczne dla polskich pacjentów, mianowicie
green represents women, red represents men, and here between the ages of 40 and 50 there's a dramatic increase in the number of women who come in, mostly complaining of insomnia. It's characteristically Polish, and it's reflected in the epidemiological data, which we'll see in a moment. When it comes to diagnosis and remembering the classification system used, we see the patients with insomnia dominate. Non-organic insomnia, that is, those in whom we do not observe any significant somatic or neurological disorders. It is basic insomnia, resulting from the mechanisms that regulate sleep, or secondary insomnia, related to stress or mental or anxiety disorders. In second place, we have organic insomnia, the type that is caused by somatic or neurological factors. Next, we have a group of patients with sleepwalking disorder and narcolepsy. Sleepwalkers, as the name implies, walk around while asleep. Narcoleptics are patients who suffer from attacks of REM sleep and constitute a very interesting group. The remaining group of patients represents hypersomnia, sleepwalking, pattern disorders, including shift work, while those with night terrors and nightmares are a much smaller number. As an interesting sidelight, the division according to another classification system, DSM-4, that classification of sleep disorders is not that precise. But as we know, there aren't 60 nor 20, but several hundred illnesses.
Jak w tej poprzedniej, czy 30, czy 20 parę, jak w tej, ale z kilkaset chorób, jak widać, też dominuje.
As you can see, the most popular is insomnia, caused by mental disorder. Next is somatic-related insomnia, sleepwalking, narcolepsy, and nearly 20 other illnesses. In the group of patients selected for this program, we see that nearly half suffer from insomnia, secondary to mental disorders, generally understood to mean all types of stress, anxiety, and adaptation disorders.
Wtórną do zaburzeń psychicznych, jak mówię, szeroko pojętych, z różnego rodzaju
However, patients with insomnia dominate in the entire group of patients.
Dominują w całej grupie pacjentów. No i może ostatnio,
final comparison as far as patients register in our clinic is concerned, among mental disorders, affective disorders dominate, that is, mood disorders and anxiety disorders. And that's in accordance with distributions cited in the literature, so that they really are the chief causes of insomnia.
Rzeczywiście jest, to są główne przyczyny wywołujące bezsenność wśród zaburzeń afektywnych.
Among affective disorders, dysthymia is in the first place. It is, in simple terms, what we used to call depressive neurosis. So it's more of a neurosis than a depression. It's characterized by a chronic depressed mood, but without the severe depressive episodes as in real depression. However, these depressed moods last a long time, and they are doubtless accompanied by chronic insomnia. One specific comment, I'd say that without a doubt, insomnia, depression disorders and anxiety disorders very often appear together. Based on present-day knowledge, the evidence seems to indicate that insomnia is a secondary symptom linked to depression and anxiety. It's true, insomnia is one of the key symptoms of depression, and it is always associated with anxiety disorders. However, the latest studies and information indicate something else. We need to know that insomnia can be an illness in and of itself.
Mianowicie należy już to powiedzieć, że bezsenność potrafi być chorobą jakby samą w sobie.
It arises as a disorder concerning the course of sleep.
However,
in patients suffering from it during depressive disorders, the number of depressive and anxiety disorders rises significantly, which I'll show you in some American research studies.
Zaburzeń depresyjnych, zaburzeń lękowych, jak za chwilę to pokażę w pracach choćby amerykańskich, rozpoznawalność depresji.
A diagnosis of depression in patients with insomnia is 20 to 30 times greater than in patients who sleep well.
Także jakby tutaj
in the distribution of psychiatric disorders in a group of patients with insomnia, it's worth remembering the cause and effect relationship is not as univocal as we assumed to this point. Patients do not succumb to depressive or anxiety disorders and then stop sleeping well. Sometimes the opposite occurs. Person stops sleeping for various reasons, exogenous included. Something is going on around him, a bad situation in life, noise, and so the patient stops sleeping. And then secondly, as a result of the insomnia, he begins to have a depressive or anxiety disorder. But this is a completely new approach to the issue and requires more work. These were the displays of application to the sleep disorders treatment clinic. However, I can show you the results of epidemiological studies. In 1996, the first epidemiological studies of the nature of sleep of Poles were carried on in Poland. We wanted to see the way Poles slept and what disorders they suffered from. I'm pleased to show you these studies, because though they were conducted by the Public Opinion Research Center, and the questions were designed by members of the Polish Association of Sleep Researchers, and I myself had an opportunity to participate in this study. 7 years ago, after the study was completed, it turned out that 24% of Poles was a poll of a representative sample, the same kind used in political polls to measure support called an omnibus study. One quarter of all Poles often, or very often, have problems with sleeping. For that's how the question was formulated. We decided to compare our results with those in the literature on studies conducted in the same manner, and it turned out the Poles were more or less on the average level of Europe. In other words, 20% to 30% of the general population have sleep problems.
Do 30% ogólnej populacji miewa problemy ze snem. Tak to wówczas wynikało. Na marginesie mogę powiedzieć, że to, co przedstawiałem przy okazji...
In reference to my earlier comments about the physiology of sleep, it turned out that Poles sleep an average of 7 to 8 hours. On weekends, an hour longer. Nearly 30% of Poles admitted to taking after-dinner naps. So we see it's not just the domain of southern countries, but a natural characteristic of our internal clock. Afternoon sleepers were mainly students and the unemployed. Obviously, they have the luxury of being able to sleep then. But I think the need for it is quite common.
Mogą sobie na spanie pozwolić, a myślę, że potrzeba jest dosyć powszechna.
These studies show that young people rarely complain of sleep problems, insomnia actually, because it represents 90% of all sleep disorders. However, half of all older people have sleep problems, which is also matched what's in the literature. Various social aspects were interesting, whether consequences or other sleep disorders. Besides insomnia, hypersomnia is also a serious problem, although the number of visits to the clinic is small, no more than a few percent of patients. However, in the general population, over 30% of Poles fall asleep watching television. So we can say it's a pretty good sleeping pill. At least it was 7 years ago. I don't know if TV these days, when we see so many tragedies and wars, is still just as good as sleeping pill. It's clear that reading and rest are factors that favor falling asleep. In this table, we see that it's a physiological excessive sleep in people who are tired or somehow stressed and need more rest. However, falling asleep at the theater during a football match while talking to someone or doing everyday tasks or eating is no doubt pathological hypersomnia. Looking at this, we cannot say which types of illnesses we are dealing with. They could just as well be apnea.
Zarówno zespół bezdechów sennych, który pragnę też powiedzieć, przypomnieć, że pierwszy...
Let me remind you that the first symptom of breathing-related disorders is hypersomnia. A person sleeps poorly at night because his respiration is inadequate. He breathes improperly and then is excessively sleepy during the day. I suspect that this is that group of patients, plus other forms of hypersomnia that evoke sleep in everyday situations, or very specific ones such as a conversation or a meal. In addition, 5% also admitted to falling asleep behind the wheel. Comparing this data with that in the literature, we can say that it is only a small percentage. But when I asked my sociologist colleagues, they claimed that not everyone asked this question admitted to it. Insomnia and falling asleep while driving are starting to become social problems. Poles, when asked 7 years ago about the causes of their sleep disorders, admitted that, in first place, it was their poor physical condition. And in second place, their poor emotional state. As we see, that matches what medicine says. With a poor material situation and family problems, the fewest respondents cited shift work. That's a certain exception. As a rule, in most types of work, one of the most common reasons for insomnia is work at night or shift work. Perhaps 7 years ago, the number of Poles working shift work wasn't very large. I also think the material situation wasn't as bad as it is today. Further information we obtained in our epidemiological study in 1996 concerned the use of sleeping pills. The results were stunning. It turned out that in comparison to studies published in the literature after similar procedures, it turned out that Poles, especially women, take more sleeping pills relatively than any other nationality. Australia is singled out here because patients tested here were older than in any other country. We obtained a shocking distribution when we compared the distribution of drug use and age. It turned out that in the group of patients older than 65, geriatric patients according to some, Poles take the most sleeping pills. It's all the more striking that according to standards commonly accepted around the world, this group of elderly patients should not take sedatives, at least not sleeping pills which contain benzodiazepine, as these have a broad range of side effects, psychomotor retardation, loss of muscle tone, memory impairment, which particularly for these patients may bring on a host of undesirable other effects. As an example, a well-known study found that elderly patients who had broken their hip, most of the group had been regularly taking sleeping pills. Because these patients have weaker muscles, poorer orientation, and so they fall over more easily and have more complications. It's an extremely worrying finding, and I'm convinced the situation hasn't changed in the intervening 7 years.
I tutaj już mogę dodać, że w ciągu tych 7 lat moim zdaniem sytuacja się nie zmieniła.
According to comparative data for the past few years, we are still in the forefront, especially when it comes to the use of sleeping pills in Poland. In Poland we still use older generation drugs with stronger suppressive qualities. I can say that presently in the world there's a tendency to use the most delicate sleeping pills. The idea is that the tablet helps the patient fall asleep relatively quickly, and then he sleeps his normal physiological sleep. That's the direction the world is going as far as sleeping pills are concerned. Basically, we're moving away from using sleeping pills permanently. That mustn't be done at all. However, in Poland, besides the fact that we take the most such drugs, they are the older generation preparations. The treatment hasn't changed for nearly 20 years. Now I'd like to show you another study, the second of two studies on the subject of sleep disorders done in Poland that was repeated in the year 2000 by the Pentor company. This study, also an omnibus type, was also conducted using the same questions with patients in four Western European countries, Italy, France, Great Britain, and Germany. What had changed in the 5 years since the prior study? When Poles were asked how they slept and what problems they had sleeping, 11 plus 23, in other words, 34% of Poles had sleep problems. However, 5% they used to have such problems, but no longer. 11% are people who have problems sleeping, but take medicine. 23% have problems, but do not treat them in any way. As we see, Poland, when compared to Europe, has nearly caught up. And more or less the same percentage, around 30% of the population, whether it's Poland, Germany, Italy, Great Britain, or France, more or less 30% of the general population has problems with sleeping. I'm not talking about problems they are aware of, not insomnia, which is very difficult to diagnose, and it is a very complicated disease with a complicated background, and so it would be difficult to expect a pollster to conduct a professional diagnosis.
diagnostykę, ale mogę na marginesie tego slajdu powiedzieć jedną rzecz. W ciągu ostatnich dwóch lat pokazały się prace epidemiologiczne, które taką wybraną populację osób zapraszały. Robiono tym pacjentom badania snu i okazało się, że wyniki są identyczne, że około 30% ogólnej populacji ma problemy ze snem, że 30% stwierdzono, że te problemy są bardzo poważne, zagrażające ich funkcjonowaniu. Przy okazji charakterystyki pacjentów z bezsenu, tutaj jest podzielona płeć na wiek, więc zgodnie z oczekiwaniami z tym, co się dzieje, że kobiety dwa razy częściej niż mężczyźni w Polsce, w Europie, cierpią na bezsenność. Jeśli chodzi o wiek, narasta, clearly that the incidence of insomnia increases with age. Please notice this. The red color is Poland. Czerwony słupek to jest Polska. In the fourth decade, the level of insomnia has doubled in the group, thanks mostly to women.
W grupie i to głównie kobiet. Także to, co żeśmy obserwowali u nas.
This is exactly what we've seen in our clinic. Women in the fourth decade of their lives begin to suffer from insomnia in large numbers. This fact is reflected in many studies. One final interesting and very essential thing, the length insomnia lasts. As we can see, nearly all Poles have chronic insomnia. Short-term insomnia, a week or a month, is barely a small percentage of the population. However, the largest percentage are those with insomnia that lasts 6 to 12 months, a year, and 3 years. This tells us several things. First, the Poles have chronic insomnia and most likely do not go see a doctor early enough. This shows us another characteristic of insomnia. It likes to become a chronic condition. Translated and narrated by Roger Domogalski.